Letters Home was commissioned by English Heritage in 2014 as part of their commemorations of the 100th anniversary of the start of the Great War. It tells a story of ordinary people in extraordinary times. The work of the post office in ensuring that people separated by war were still able to communicate and share their experiences by letter. We were inspired by the way that something so simple could be of such enormous importance, how it touched every family and provided a lasting testimony to those who lived and died.
Imagine a world where the letter is king. There's no Facebook, no Twitter, no WhatsApp, no Bing.
No laptops, no tablets, no mobile phones, no telephone boxes, no dialing tones.
No answering machines, no faxes, no pagers. The home phones for those born to wealth or high wages.
Now you may think this world sounds like utter bliss. Go back 100 years and that's how it is.
If you want to share news with a friend out of sight, then you walk, meet and talk.
Or you stop, sit and write.
If you want to share news with a distant relation, a letter's the best form of communication.
That means you need paper, a pen and some ink. You need to find time to record what you think.
And once you have written what you want to say, buy a stamp, find a postbox, send it on its way.
And if you think this sounds like a terrible chore...
Now imagine you're doing this and fighting a war. In a trench. In the smoke. And the dirt. And the stink.
And you want to write home to say you're in the pink. With shells whizzing by, you might write to your folks.
To send you some comforts. A cake or some smokes.
Some hand-knitted mittens or socks would be nice.
Or that powder you put in your clothes to kill lice.
Because when you're in danger and far from your home, a letter reminds you you're not on your own.
On land or at sea, in khaki or blue, a letter says someone is thinking of you.
And it's more than just words, scratched on paper with pen. You can read it for comfort, again and again.
When your rations are gone and you're shivering with cold, for the men in the front line, a letter's like gold.
Because knowing that everything at home is all right is good for morale and keeps men in the fight.
A letter from home, when conditions are chronic, lifts the spirits of men in dire need of a tonic.
So imagine this world of carnage and mud.
Where a few yards of land gained is paid for in blood.
When you haven't the first idea of when it will end.
And the next whiz-bang might land on you or your friend.
When something simple somehow can make you feel better.
Like receiving a parcel or opening a letter.
Letters were recognised as a vital part of keeping up the morale of men on the front line. As well as rations and ammunition, letters and parcels had to get through.
The army had its own postal service. The men, the Royal Engineers Postal Section, or REPS for short.
And here's how it worked.
From Tommy in the trench
to Sweetheart at home.
So, Tommy wants to write a letter or send a postcard home. He's going to use a pencil. Easier to use in a trench than pen and ink. He writes on active service on the envelope, and then it doesn't need a stamp.
The letters are collected at field post offices, in dugouts, tents or barns. The FPOs offer the same services as a normal post office.
And you can find them easy enough. They've got a white and red flag.
The letters are postmarked, put into sacks, taken by lorry to the divisional railhead, when they are then loaded onto trains.
The trains then transport them to Boulogne, Calais or Havre, where they are loaded onto steamships. Then it's the short journey across the channel and into the care of the post office.
The letters are then taken by rail or road to London, where they are sorted again before being sent out to families waiting anxiously for news.
Sometimes the letters gave a real insight into the war.
From an officer of the Argyll and Southern Highlanders.
It's a war with no glamour or glory such as one expects in a worldwide show like this. Modern weapons are too deadly, and the whole art of war and all tactics as laid down in our books has been quite altered. No advancing across the open by short rushes. Now it's all digging new lines of trenches by night.
Sometimes they were a little briefer.
From a private, the Royal Fusiliers. I hope this letter finds you as it leaves me. I've got a bit of shrapnel in my bottom.
Some were more to the point.
From a gunner of the Royal Artillery. You can send me another tin of boracic ointment. It's very useful.
And some were downright strange.
From Dick to Molly.
A happy Christmas. I'm sending this to my aunt to forward to you as I do not know the address. Please tell me your name, as I've forgotten it.
And yet they all got through.
From an officer somewhere in France. 30th of December 1914.
I got three letters, posted in Ireland on the 26th and in England on the 28th, this afternoon. So letters are reaching us as quickly as if there were no war. It's really rather wonderful. It's amazing to imagine that a system that relied on handwritten instructions, typed orders, telephone communications, card indexes, and manpower could be so incredibly efficient.
And as the war went on, the post office relied less and less on manpower and more on women power.
Men to the trenches.
Women to the benches.
So jobs in the post office that had previously been thought of as being a male-only preserve had to be done by whatever labour was available. And that meant...
women porters, sorters, drivers. Women were even delivering the post.
Christmas 1914. Princess Mary got behind a fund to send a brass tin of comforts, sweets, tobacco, pencils, writing paper and pictures of the royal family to every member of the armed services.
That's soldiers and sailors.
The idea caught on. The public raised money.
The tins were manufactured and sent out. It was a triumph for morale boosting.
But it was a nightmare for logistics.
The post office and the reps were just about able to cope, but not everyone got their gift on Christmas Day.
Happy New Year.
Letters home that Christmas of 1914 spoke of strange events at the front.
From a private of the Queen's Westminster Rifles. Friday, 25th, Christmas Day. Freezing and a bit misty. We started walking about behind the trench, and after a bit we got out the front. And we saw Germans doing the same. We waved. They did. Until at last we got so close that five of us went over to meet five of them and started exchanging keepsakes, buttons and the like. It seemed the weirdest thing in the world that we were talking to the men that we were trying to shoot the day before.
Families were getting news of the war that wasn't in the newspaper. The Christmas truce of 1914 would be a moment of respite that wouldn't be repeated. High command didn't approve.
Luckily, the army had a way of pinching the flow of information.
Censorship.
Every letter written by a private soldier home had to be read by their officer. And they could take a blue pencil and scratch out anything that they thought was unsuitable.
This made many officers feel uncomfortable.
From an officer of the Royal Field Artillery, it is always with mixed feelings that I personally view the arrival of fresh paper, because the soldiers write such awful things in their letters, mostly rot or else a repetition of a few remarks they could quite easily put on a postcard, and I have to read them all through. But it certainly makes them happy. And that is the great thing.
For young officers, public school educated, with little experience of the working class man, their men's letters gave a window into Tommy's world.
They have big hearts, these soldiers. And it is a very pathetic task to have to read all their letters home. Some of the older men with wives and families who write every day have in their style a wonderful simplicity, which is almost great literature. There is much to be learned from a soldier's letter.
I have just censored the letters of my men. By Jove, if you could read some of these letters, they would do you good. The tenderness of these great rough fellows is wonderful. I love them all.
Wherever the British Army sent its soldiers, the men of the Royal Engineers Postal Section were never far behind.
To Gallipoli.
To Salonika, to Mesopotamia.
West Africa, Italy.
Russia, the Balkans.
The officers wanted to keep their men occupied. A busy soldier, so the thinking went, didn't have time to ponder on the situation he was in.
And letter writing provided a partial solution. Give the men something to occupy themselves. Remind them of what they are fighting for.
And so, behind the lines in France, and back here in Blighty, a whole industry sprung up producing postcards of all types to be sent to and from the front lines.
There were the patriotic. God save the king.
The anti-Kaiser, down with little Willie.
Flags of the Allies.
Ships of the Navy.
You could go to a photographer's studio and have your picture taken, have it turned into a postcard, and you could send that home.
Vesta Tilly, the music hall star, sold postcards of herself dressed as an officer to raise money for soldiers' funds. But more often than not, it was the humorous postcards, poking fun at Tommy in the trench and gently mocking the changing world of the home front, that made its way back and forth across the channel.
Well, if you knows a better hole, go to it.
In 1916, 16,000 sacks of mail was being transported daily. That's 16,000 sacks to be sorted, sent and delivered. And nearly all of it came through London.
The existing sorting office in London at Mount Pleasant just wasn't big enough to cope.
And so the post office built Home Depot in Regent's Park. A huge wooden shed. More sheds were added to keep pace with the growing number of military fronts and the growing number of men being sent out.
It was massive. It was a vast complex of sorting rooms, storerooms and offices. It covered 5 acres. That's the same as 3 football pitches.
Hundreds of women, cross-referencing, checking lists, card indexes, working in shifts to keep the post moving.
By the end of the war, Home Depot was the largest man-made wooden construction in the world. And the letters home kept coming in.
My darling mother and father, I am writing on the eve of my first action. Tomorrow we go to the attack in the greatest battle the British Army has ever fought. I cannot quite express my feelings on this night, and cannot tell if it's God's will that I shall come through. But if I fall in battle, then I have no regrets, save for my loved ones I leave behind. If I do fall, do not let things be black for you. Be cheerful, and you will be living life always to my memory.
We're just off to the front, and maybe in action in a few hours' time. In case of my misfortune to go under, to my boy, I wish him to be a good, brave and real English laddie. Do not worry or fret, as that is no use, but be as cheerful as possible to help others.
My dear boy Fred, this is a letter you will never see unless your daddy falls in the field. It is his farewell words to you in case anything happens.
Dearest Gwyn, I am writing just a line in case of accidents. Just to let you know that I've always loved you, dear. You are the best little girl on God's earth, have I told you before? But I'm writing this because I have a feeling I shall not come back again. My last wish is that you marry a good man and be happy. And to think of you humble now and then.
A parcel came into our trenches with our rations, addressed to a bomber, a personal friend of mine, who had been killed the previous day. It is the practice for such parcels to be split up among the addressee's friends. This parcel contained many little things which we find useful in the trenches, and among them a pair of gloves. These were given to a fellow who'd lost his, but half an hour later he called us together again and said, "I say, you chaps, listen to this. I can't use these gloves." He then read out, not in a steady voice, a short message written on a slip of paper which he had found tucked inside one of the gloves. It was just to say that they were sent to dear Harry with his mother's love, and nobody save her had ever touched them. Just before packing them up, she'd put them on, so Harry could imagine when he wore them that he was holding his mother's hand.
By the time the war to end all wars finally came to its end, the post office had handled more than 2 billion letters.
To and from soldiers, sailors, airmen, nurses, prisoners of war, and families back home.
The post office had dealt with 114 million parcels.
But when the boys came home, it was all forgotten.
Letters got put away, slowly pushed to the back of drawers.
Home depot closed, fell into disuse, and is now but a memory.
People wanted to move on. They wanted to look to the future. The past is the past, after all.
So imagine again this world we have lost,
where victory was won at a terrible cost.
As the words of these people stretch down through the years,
to show us their feelings, their hopes, and their fears.
When we look at their letters and postcards, because
they were ordinary people. They were people
like us.